the greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Good afternoon, I'm Denise Dinsai, and here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. Senator Panfilo Lacson claims Partido Reforma switched sides not because of his low rank in surveys, but due to an issue in campaign funds. Malacañang says President Duterte is not endorsing any presidential bet despite his meeting with Bongbong Marcos. And U.S. President Joe Biden calls for Russia's expulsion from G20. Welcome to the program. For those watching online, thanks for joining us. The president of Partido Reforma clarifies only the Davao del Norte chapter of the party is throwing their support behind the candidacy of Vice President Lenny Robredo. But given their ties to the leaders in other provinces in the region, Davao del Norte Representative Pantaleon Alvarez is confident they can still deliver a large number of votes for Robredo. Senator Ping Lacson quit Partido Reforma on Thursday, shortly before Alvarez switched sides.
Kasama ko yung aking gobernador, no? At yung mga kaalyado dito. Tumatawag din sa mga kaibigan namin sa ibang probinsya. Kung pwede, ay samahan kami sa pagsuporta kay VP Lenny Robredo. Kung makukumbinsi natin na sumama sa pagsuporta kay VP Lenny, eh malaki-laki po yun. Kung 1 million lang, kayang-kaya yun.
Alvarez also cites his fears of another Marcos presidency for their decision.
Karamihan, ano, yung mga kabataan na hindi nila alam kung gaano kalupit yung dekada 80, yung panahon ni Ferdinand Marcos. Yung constitution naman, kung talagang magaling yung yung namumuno, pwede pa rin lusutan yan. Mm-hmm. Yung constitution natin ngayon, yung mga mm-hmm. safeguards, ah, kung talagang yung presidente mo gustuhin, mm-hmm. Wala tayong magagawa dyan.
Time to call a spade. Senator Pamphilo Lacson dares the president of his former political party to disclose the true reason he shifted support. He claims it was not about his low ranking in surveys, but about campaign funds. Lacson says Alvarez's chief of staff was asking for 800 million pesos in additional funding, which he declined to give. Lacson reiterates he harbors no ill feelings for what Alvarez did. The endorsement of Partido Reforma not only provides a huge boost to the campaign of Vice President Robredo. Her spokesperson, Barry Gutierrez, says the support also conveys a strong message. People who disagree can find common ground and work together. He explains Robredo's campaign is all about welcoming people from different backgrounds based on shared principles.
It's very, very helpful. And I think that the vice president was very, very clear on that yesterday in their press conference. Because aside from the sheer support in terms of the party's numbers, in terms of the leaders that will now be campaigning for the vice president, there is a huge symbolic value to the support from for Partido Reforma. As mentioned by Congressman Alvarez earlier, he and VP Robredo have not always had a good relationship. They have been on opposite sides of the political fence at one point, but now they are together, and that's a very, very strong symbol that people who may have had disagreements before.
But for a political analyst, it seems personality politics is what really pushed Alvarez to endorse Robredo.
The camp of Vice President Lenny saying that still they're going to support the vice presidency of Senator Kiko Pangilinan. So, again, that goes to show that, the idea of shared programs and shared policies is secondary only, if at all it is really a factor in determining a party's or a group's support to a particular candidate. The main consideration really is the personality. It's nothing unusual. I don't even call our political setup a political system anymore. Everything has become really out and out, just dependent on personalities.
The Robredo camp also asserts it will not drop its support for her running mate, Senator Kiko Pangilinan. See several government officials as well as allies of the vice president and Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio are pushing for an all-women tandem for 2022.
We understand that there will be groups, there will be parties, there will be local officials who will choose to have some other configuration. Mm-mm. And we respect them. That's the thing with our system. The president and the vice president are not elected in tandem, but insofar as the vice president and insofar as the campaign is concerned, our vice presidential bet is Senator Kiko mm-hmm. Pangilinan, and we will be doing everything we can in the next 45 days to ensure that he, who has been chosen by the vice president as her preferred partner in governance, will be elected as VP come May.
Meanwhile, Albay Representative Joey Salceda sees more local officials going for a Robredo-Duterte tandem.
There are at least 17 provinces where they both won. I mean, Duterte and VP Lenny, Agusta del Norte, Nidagat, Southern Leyte, Cebu, Bohol, Lano del Norte, Lano del Sur, Misamis Oriental, Bukidnon, Maguindanao, Tawi-Tawi, Basilan, Batangas, Zamboanga, Sibugay, Zamboanga City, Lapu-Lapu City. That's 11 million voters. Mm-hmm. So right now we have about 7 or openly declared, but I know of at least 20, additional 20, who will soon come out for Lenny Sara.
Malacanang insists President Rodrigo Duterte has not endorsed any presidential candidate yet. The clarification comes following Duterte's meeting with presidential aspirant Bongbong Marcos, the running mate of her daughter, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio. His party, the Cusi Wing of PDP Laban, has also endorsed Marcos for president.
Acting presidential spokesperson and PCO Secretary Martin Andanar, my boss, confirmed to the media yesterday or 2 days ago that a meeting did occur between President Duterte and Senator Marcos. So that we are sure of. Whether or not this can be interpreted as an endorsement, of course the president has not endorsed any candidate. A meeting was just arranged and they met President Duterte and Senator Marcos, but there is no endorsement insofar as Malacañang is concerned.
Malacañang has said the meeting between Duterte and Marcos was cordial. It added, Duterte merely shared his experiences as president with Marcos. A former Supreme Court justice believes one of the reasons Bongbong Marcos is gunning for the presidency is to avoid paying hundreds of billions of pesos in estate tax liabilities. Let's hear more from Warren de Guzman.
The Supreme Court ruled the over 23 billion peso estate tax assessment on the Marcos family as final and executory in 1997. With the annual penalty on the non-payment of estate taxes set at a hefty 20%, that assessment ballooned to over 203 billion. Former Supreme Court Justice Antonio Carpio believes Ferdinand Marcos Jr., the administrator of the Marcos estate alongside his mother Imelda Marcos, may have decided to run for president to avoid paying that tax liability.
Marcoses have developed a counter strategy. They will make the right to collect of the government prescribe. Once he is in president, nobody will file a notice demand letter on him. And he has a term of 6 years, and it takes only 5 years for the prescriptive period to set in. So that is their counter strategy. So he becomes president, I'm certain that 203 billion will be gone forever.
Each crime has a prescription period wherein the victim or the government must act. Otherwise, they lose their right to bring the offender to justice. Carpio says as long as the government sends demand letters to Marcos, the prescription period of 5 years to collect the estate tax will always reset. As president, Marcos can order the BIR not to send the letter. Former BIR Commissioner Kimenara says the Bureau of Internal Revenue should file a criminal case against Marcos to collect, and Carpio agrees.
If you are legally obliged to pay the tax and you willfully refuse to pay the tax, you are criminally liable, up to 10 years imprisonment. And that's why I'm saying the BIR, if it wants to now, it can file a criminal case. And I think it's time because 25 years almost. Almost a quarter of a century, they have not paid the tax. Ano pang iniintay ng BIR?
The law provides such a remedy. But I just like to point out that if BBM becomes president, I think for 6 years, because of the presidential immunity, you might not be able to file a criminal case.
Carpio and Henares aren't the only ones pushing for the BIR to file a criminal case against Marcos Jr. The Alliance of Women for Action Towards Reform, or AWARE, posted a petition to this end on March 20th. Since then, it has garnered over 18,000 signatures.
We'll try our best to put pressure on BIR Commissioner Dulay and the other commissioners to act on this petition that they file a criminal case against Marcos. And if not, it is a pressure point. It's an election issue campaign.
I don't know why BIR has to be pressured by all these signatures. It's the law.
ABS-CBN is still trying to get a reaction from Marcos Jr. and the BIR. AWARE and Justice Carpio support the presidential bid of Vice President Lenny Robredo. Commissioner Henares supports the presidential bid of Senator Ping Lacson. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
A data analyst has some concerns about the methodologies of election surveys. Professor Francisco de los Reyes calls on the public to demand polling companies to disclose all their information regarding their surveys to legitimize the results. He adds survey results do not necessarily reflect what will happen on election day.
The public should know that the surveys are done in one point in time. It's a point in time snapshot of what's happening right now, here and now. It's not cast in stone. As each day passes, there is an anticipated new thing happening. So there could be certain turning points that may happen in the next 45 days.
Thousands of candidates for local positions across the Philippines start wooing voters as the campaign period for local bets begins. In vote-rich Quezon City, incumbent Mayor Joy Belmonte launches her re-election bid in a proclamation rally. She will be running against Anak Kalusugan party-list Representative Mike Defensor and seven more candidates. Over in Marikina, local candidates begin their campaigns by conducting house-to-house visits. Bayani Fernando aims to reclaim the mayoral post as he challenges incumbent Mayor Marcelino Teodoro. And in Pasig, incumbent Mayor Vico Soto holds a mini-campaign rally to formally launch his re-election bid. Soto's bid for a second term is being challenged by incumbent Vice Mayor Io Bernardo. In Batangas, the start of the local campaign period is somewhat toned down as gubernatorial bets kick off their campaigns with a prayer. Dennis Datu now joins us on the line for more. Go ahead, Dennis.
It is the start of the campaign season for local positions here in the province of Batangas. It's a bit toned down compared to other provinces as two leaders eyeing the gubernatorial seat kick off their respective campaigns with a mass. Incumbent Batangas Governor Hermelinda Mandanas, who is celebrating his 78th birthday today, attended a mass in the provincial capital this morning together with his party mates and supporters. Mandanas is gunning for his last term as the provincial governor. Since he started his political career in 1995, Mandanas has never lost an election. His closest rival in the gubernatorial race is former Padre Garcia Mayor Prudencio Dacio Gutierrez. He was a mayor of the said town from 2004 until 2013. Gutierrez claimed that he has the backing of the majority of the mayors in the province who have silently pledged their support to his campaign. Gutierrez added that his mayors were dissatisfied on how Mandanas handled the recent crisis they have faced, including the eruption of Taal Volcano and the COVID-19 pandemic. The Batangas PNP has placed 11 municipalities in one city under election areas of concern due to heated political rivalries. These places include Nasugbu, Lian, Tuwi, Balayan, Calatagan, Lemery, Calaca, Taal, Mataas, Nakahoy, Bawan, Laurel, and Santo Tomas City. According to Batangas PNP Director Terrell Glicero Cancilao, the identified areas of concern have a series of intense political rivalry that needs massive attention. Since last night, authorities have deployed police personnel and conducted checkpoints in several areas in the province to ensure everyone's safety and security. Denise.
Thanks for that report, Dennis. Now we're taking a quick break. Coming up, U.S. President Joe Biden pushes for Russia's expulsion from the G20. More on that when we come back. Stay with ANC's Rundown.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
President Joe Biden officially calling for Russia's expulsion from G20. This follows a day of intense global diplomacy in Brussels as world leaders gather to discuss further sanctions against Russia for its invasion of Ukraine. Biden says if other nations would not support kicking Russia out of G20, Ukraine should be able to participate in their meetings. One wild card in U.S. efforts to economically pressure Russia relies on China's next move.
I had a very straightforward conversation with Xi now, I guess it's 6 days ago, 7 days ago in that range. And I made it clear to him, I made no threats, but I made it clear to him that make sure he understood the consequences of him helping Russia. China understands that its economic future is much more closely tied to the West than it is to Russia. And so I'm hopeful that he does not get engaged.
Biden is headed to Poland next to witness firsthand the plight of refugees who fled the war. Poland houses the most Ukrainian refugees. It has taken in more than 2.1 million since the invasion began. The U.S. is also ramping up humanitarian aid for Ukraine by opening its doors to 100,000 refugees fleeing the war. Details in this report.
The Biden administration announced on Thursday that the United States plans to accept up to 100,000 Ukrainians fleeing Russia's invasion, while also pledging $1 billion in new humanitarian aid. This news comes after a month of bombardments touched off Europe's fastest-moving refugee crisis since the end of World War II, and coincides with U.S. President Joe Biden's meeting with European leaders in Brussels to coordinate the Western response to the crisis.
This is not something that Poland or Romania or Germany should carry on their own. This is an international responsibility. The United States, as a leader, one of the leaders in the international community, has an obligation to be engaged and do all we can to ease the suffering and pain of innocent women and children and men, for that matter, throughout Ukraine and those who have made it across the border.
So far, more than 3.5 million people have fled Ukraine since Russia invaded on February 24th, putting a strain on the neighboring European countries receiving them. As a result, U.S. lawmakers and advocates have urged Biden to do more to help those seeking refuge in the United States. The Biden administration said in a statement it would use the full range of legal pathways to bring Ukrainians to the United States, including the U.S. Refugee Resettlement Program. The current effort to allow more Ukrainians into the United States is part of a broader series of aid measures announced by the Biden administration on Thursday, including $1 billion in new funding toward humanitarian assistance to support people still in Ukraine and those affected by the global impacts of Russia's war, which Russia calls a special military operation. The Biden administration will launch a new democracy and human rights program that aims to provide at least $320 million in new funding to defend human rights in Ukraine and neighboring countries.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky asserts his country should be in the European Union in the near future. In his video address to the regional bloc, Zelensky thanked the EU for imposing sweeping sanctions against Russia in response to its invasion. But he says these steps, although strong, were a little too late.
Because if it had been preventive, Russia would not start a war. There was a chance. You blocked Nord Stream 2. But it was also a little late. Because if it were on time, Russia would not have created a gas crisis. At least, there was such a chance. Now you and I are preparing Ukraine's membership in the European Union. Finally, here I am asking you not to be late. Please, because during this month, you have compared these worlds and you see everything. You saw who is worth what, and you saw that Ukraine should be in the EU in the near future.
In the days following Russia's invasion, Ukraine officially applied for EU membership and asked for immediate approval. But the regional bloc said it would not rush the application process. The UN General Assembly adopts a new non-binding resolution demanding an immediate halt to Russia's war in Ukraine. 140 countries, including the Philippines, voted in favor of the measure. 5 voted against it, and 38 abstained. The resolution also criticizes Russia for creating a dire humanitarian situation, demanding aid access and civilian protection in the Ukraine. Russia, which has denied attacking civilians, calls the draft a pseudo-humanitarian solution that takes a one-sided view of the situation.
Today, once again, the world stood united. It stood united in the face of President Putin's unjustified and unprovoked invasion of Ukraine. Together, a strong majority of UN member states made clear that Russia bears sole responsibility for the grave humanitarian crisis and violence in Ukraine. Together, we called for the protection of all civilians fleeing the conflict and for steps to mitigate the increase in food insecurity caused by this senseless war. And together, we reaffirmed the UN Charter.
As Western leaders gather in Brussels, Ukrainians across the country shelter in metro stations, with cities around them reduced into rubble. Here's a look at the life in Ukraine 1 month since Russia's invasion.
A month into Russia's invasion, this is life in Ukraine. Cities reduced to rubble, long lines for humanitarian aid, and hundreds sheltering underground, like in Kharkiv's metro system. Natalia Shaposhnik and her daughter Veronika have been living in a blue and yellow train far underground Kharkiv, Ukraine's second largest city since the beginning of Russia's invasion.
Surely it's not better than home, but it is livable. One can say our living conditions are better than others. What I mean is we are not right on the platform. My child and I are in the carriage. We get food, there is a toilet. We are doing fine.
For 4 long weeks, Sapochnik and hundreds like her have hunkered down inside the station in the north of the city, many of whom have endured near daily shelling. Above them, destroyed or heavily damaged buildings line the eerily quiet streets. Anastasia Horkova is a local journalist.
Here, there are about 250 people sheltering here. Many go out during the day to breathe fresh air, go to the supermarket, and this flew here.
A couple hundred miles to the south, the scene is no better in the battered city of Mariupol, where long lines for humanitarian aid have filled a former shopping center. Alexandra is a local resident.
My husband didn't make it to receive humanitarian aid. He had diabetes. The scarce diet of the last days led him into a coma and he died. If he could have made it for the aid, he'd be alive. I still can't tell the Russian relatives he passed away.
Many have evacuated the port city for temporary shelter in Russia's southern city of Taganrog, like pediatrician Galina Ovchinnikova.
We were eating once a day. All we have cooked in the morning, we were eating during the whole day. And the rest of the time, we were sitting in the basement. It was dirty there and dark. We were burning candles, making oil lamps. It was cold there.
83-year-old Raisa Kairat said she lost contact with her daughter and grandchild when the siege started.
So beautiful Mariupol used to be, and suddenly it was reduced to dust. How dare you fire at people? They are animals, not humans. Kindergartens, stores, schools. School nearby was destroyed. Why would anyone shoot at the houses where people lived? What for?
Russia continues to deny targeting civilians and calls its invasion a special military operation.
Berlin's top ballet company welcomes ballerinas fleeing the horrors of war in Ukraine, along with dancers wanting to leave Russia. Take a look.
Practicing their pliés and pirouettes in downtown Berlin, many of these ballerinas have been through hell, having fled the horrors of war in Ukraine. They've recently been welcomed into the fold of Berlin's main ballet company by prima ballerina Yana Selenko.
They want just to give up. They don't know how to go on with this situation. So, and of course, I feel like if I can help, it makes me happy.
The Kiev-born dancer, who has been in the German capital since 2005, has worked tirelessly over the last month to help those in need continue with their training.
They are really happy. They're just thankful for everything, what I can do and what I could help. And I feel this really love, like, oh, really, thank you. I thought I will never come back. And when they have a chance to connect it with the people or come in here to do the class, and it feels like I did my job. And of course, it's just little job, but I feel this happiness.
But it's not just Ukrainian dancers who are looking for a position at the Berlin State Ballet. Dancers from other countries, including Russia, are also keen to join the ensemble. According to ballet dramaturg Christian Theobald, the Berlin Opera prides itself on being a melting pot of global talent.
We have many, many nationalities here, and we have an important duty to ensure Russophobia doesn't emerge and that we continue to value each other just as before as we carry on.
Together, Theobald and Selenko are not only helping the displaced ballerinas with accommodation, ballet shoes, and practice space, they are also trying to get the dancers auditions at ballet companies abroad or in other fields such as the opera.
And that's the rundown. I'm Denise Tinsai. Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.